Hello, we're going to go ahead and get started. It's good to see everyone. So welcome to the SBRB Seminar Series. This is a twice yearly seminar where we bring in distinguished speakers that can inform our work at the intersection of genomics and society, and really to showcase the very best of social behavioral science as it interfaces with health. I'm really pleased today to welcome Mark Hatzenbuehler, professor of psychology at Harvard, who does truly innovative work on biopsychosocial mechanisms contributing to adverse mental health outcomes among members of minoritized groups. Dr. Hatzenbuehler got his PhD in clinical psychology from Yale. He completed his postdoc training at Columbia, where he received a Robert Wood Johnson Foundational Health and Society Scholarship. Before he was at Harvard, he was an associate professor at the Department of Socio-Medical Sciences at Columbia. Dr. Hatzenbuehler's research has been funded by NIH, CDC, the William T. Grant Foundation. He has many, many awards, many distinguished scientific contribution recognitions, and is a fellow of the Academy of Behavioral Medicine Research and recipient of the American Psychological Foundation Gold Medal Award. I just like that it's a gold medal for impact in psychology. So we are really pleased to have him here today with us, and I will turn it over.
Thank you so much for the invitation. I have to say, when I got Susan's email, I first looked at the signature and saw genome, and I was like, I think she has the wrong person. But then after that, I saw social behavioral, and I was like, okay, these are my people. So I'm happy to be here. And I've had a great day of conversations with several folks, some of whom I know do work in the stigma space, which is great, but also many of you don't, which is also great. But I'm hoping that given that within the broad field of social and behavioral influences on health, there's been increasing attention to thinking about how to measure and analyze the broader structural environment in which people are embedded. And so I'm hoping that even if you don't work in the stigma space, you'll learn something from our approaches and apply those to areas in which you all work. So when you think about this term stigma, you probably immediately think about concrete events and experiences that happen to people, things like hate crimes and bullying or being the target of stereotypes. And those of you who are psychologically minded might also think about some of the psychological responses that members of stigmatized groups have to these concrete events and experiences, things like anticipating rejection, becoming hypervigilant to threat cues in the environment, or concealing aspects of your stigmatized identity if you're able in order to avoid rejection and discrimination. And of course, you wouldn't be wrong for thinking this. There are decades of research from across the social sciences showing that these are forms of stigma that matter for the health and well-being of the stigmatized. At the same time, though, this is just the proverbial tip of the iceberg. Stigma is much broader than these concrete events and experiences and responses. It's promulgated and reinforced through our social institutions, through the laws and policies that we choose to pass or not pass, and finally through broad cultural norms and attitudes and stereotypes that we hold about members of stigmatized groups. And collectively, this is what my colleagues and I call structural stigma. And this metaphor of stigma as an iceberg is consistent with how stigma has been conceptualized in the broader social science literature, which is as a multi-level construct ranging from individual to structural levels. So very briefly, individual forms of stigma refer to the psychological processes through which stigmatized individuals both perceive and react to stigma. Psychologists have identified numerous individual-level stigma processes, including self-stigma or the internalization of negative societal attitudes about your group, and also concealment behaviors. In contrast, interpersonal forms of stigma refer to the interactions that occur between the stigmatized and the non-stigmatized. These can include overt events like discriminatory treatment, as well as more subtle interactional processes. Now, the vast majority of research across the social sciences has really existed at these two levels of analysis, the individual and interpersonal. And that work has been enormously important because it's documented many of the ways in which stigma operates to produce disadvantage. But at the same time, this work has been criticized for overlooking broader structural and institutional forms of stigma, which my colleagues and I defined as societal level conditions, cultural norms, and institutional policies and practices that affect the lives of the stigmatized. And this lack of research on structural forms of stigma relative to stigma at the individual and interpersonal levels of analysis has been called by my colleague Bruce Link a dramatic shortcoming in the literature on stigma, as the processes involved are likely major contributors to unequal outcomes. So what explains this lack of research on structural forms of stigma relative to stigma at the individual and interpersonal levels of analysis? Well, one of the reasons is the challenge that the field has confronted in how to go about measuring and operationalizing this construct. Because as I mentioned, most of the literature had been analyzing and therefore measuring stigma only at the individual and interpersonal levels of analysis. So this point is demonstrated in a review paper that Bruce Link and his colleagues did many years ago, reviewing some of the different methods and approaches for measuring stigma related to mental illness. Those are shown here on the left-hand side. So aspects related, for example, to labeling and stereotyping of mental illness. And you can see here that they found only two studies, so fewer than 2%, that it actually measured structural forms of stigma related to mental illness. More recently, a set of scholars conducted a literature review on structural racism. And whereas they found over 477,000 articles in a web of science search on race and health, when they replaced race with structural or systemic racism, just 0.4% of the articles remained. So the articles concluded with, the authors concluded with a sobering assessment of this literature, noting, quote, "The stark reality is that research investigating the relationship between structural racism and population health outcomes has been scant." So you can see here across these two very different forms of stigma, a common theme of the lack of structural level measures of stigma in research. And so that was one of the major challenges that I was confronting when I started to do this work. But it just so happened that when I started studying this topic about a decade ago, that an opportunity to measure structural stigma emerged in the form of the state level policy landscape surrounding one particular stigmatized group, in this case LGBT people, which had begun to rapidly change. So this is a figure that shows this, that demonstrates the state policy climate varies really dramatically across US states. These are policies related to both gender identity and sexual orientation. This is a policy group that collects about 40 different state level policies in multiple different policy domains, things like relationship protections, non-discrimination, criminal justice, and the like. In red states are those states that have policies that curtail or restrict rights. In orange states are those that have a low number of protective policies. And finally, states in dark green have a large number of policy protections. And so you can see here that in over half of states still have no or very few legal protections for the LGBTQ community. In addition to this geographic variation, there's also temporal variability. So this figure shows that the state policy climate has changed pretty dramatically over the past decade or so, with some states really expanding rights and protections and others continuing to restrict them. And so this variability meant that we had a measure of structural stigma in the form of state policies that were varying over both geographic time and space. And that was something that was much less discernible and much less pronounced for most other stigmatized groups at the time that we started studying this. And so this meant that we had a test case through studying LGBT populations where we could set about testing a broader set of questions about the potential consequences of structural and institutional forms of stigma. And so we set about trying to do that, to examine how changes in these structural forms of stigma may affect the health of LGBT populations. So in the first part of my talk today, I'm going to walk through three different types of study designs that we've used to give you a sense of a multi-method approach that we have employed to examine this question. So one approach that we have used is quasi-experiments, where we capitalize on the rapidly changing policy environment surrounding LGBT populations that I just mentioned. One of the methodological advantages of the use of these quasi or natural experiments is that they represent exogenous events that occur outside the control of individuals and therefore minimize threats to validity of self-selection into the exposure status, in this case, structural stigma. So we've used this approach in a number of different studies. For the sake of time today, I'll just present one example of this work. And this was a paper that my colleague Julia Rafeman took the lead on. So in this study, Joy used a difference in difference analysis. This is an econometrics approach for use with quasi-experimental data that enabled us to compare changes in mental distress among LGB individuals and heterosexuals who lived in three states that had recently passed laws denying services to same-sex couples in public accommodations in the year 2015. So this was our indicator of structural stigma in this study. And we then compared those to changes in mental distress among LGB individuals and heterosexuals who lived in six geographically nearby control states that had nearly identical demographic characteristics but had not implemented one of these laws denying services to same-sex couples. Our data on mental health and sexual orientation come from the Behavior Risk Factor Surveillance System. These are representative data sets of non-institutionalized state residents of individuals who are 18 and over. And then finally, we used data from 2014, 2015, and 2016. At the time of this study, these were all available years since the CDC first included an optional module that enabled states to opt in and assess sexual orientation. So the reason I'm using LGB here is there is no T because at the time, most of the population-based data sets were not measuring gender identity. That's its own form of structural stigma. I will not get on my soapbox about that right now, but we can return to that during the Q&A. But so I'm only able to measure structural forms of stigma here relative to sexual orientation. So in the first set of analyses I'm going to show you here, I'm showing you a figure depicting the trends in mental distress in the 3 years leading up to the implementation of those policies, stratified by states that ultimately went on to pass them versus control states that didn't. And you can see here that there are no pre-existing differences in mental distress time trends between states that pass these laws denying services to same-sex couples versus control states. And so this evidence for what we call parallel trends means that we can be more confident that any observed changes that occurred after the implementation of these policies aren't due to pre-existing differences in rates of mental distress between those two groups of states. So here's the figure for our main results. This figure shows the changes in the percentage of adults experiencing mental distress in states that passed those laws denying services to same-sex couples stratified versus control states stratified by sexual orientation and identity. On the y-axis here is the percentage of the population meeting criteria for mental distress, and on the x-axis are the three different time points. So 2014 is baseline year, 2015 is the year in which the policy was implemented, and 2016 is the follow-up year. So you can see here that the only group to experience a significant increase in rates of mental distress were the LGB individuals living in one of those states that passed the laws denying services to same-sex couples shown in the gray triangle here. And that's equivalent to about a 46% relative increase in sexual minorities experiencing mental distress in states that passed those laws denying services to same-sex couples versus control states. In contrast, you can see for the other three comparison groups that there's no reliable change at all in rates of mental distress. So we're documenting specificity just to the stigmatized group that's been exposed to these structural forms of stigma. And the reason that result specificity is important is that when relationships between structural stigma and adverse outcomes are shown only among the stigmatized group, it increases the likelihood that the results are due to structural stigma itself and not to non-stigma related factors with which it might be associated, like, for example, worse economic conditions. These non-stigma related factors would be expected to affect the health of all individuals living in that area, not just the stigmatized group, in this case, LGB individuals. In this study, we also use state fixed effects, and that does two things. First, it controls for baseline differences in rates of mental distress across states. And secondly, it controls for unmeasured factors, like, for example, the political climate that could theoretically influence both the passage of these laws and also the mental health of individuals living in those states. And then finally, we also use year fixed effects, and that controls for time invariant characteristics that could spuriously influence the results, like, for example, the legalization of same-sex marriage by the U.S. Supreme Court, which occurred in 2015 during the study period. So in this study and several others like it that we and other research groups have conducted, we've been examining how very short-term changes in structural forms of stigma as a result of these shifts in policies may be associated with short-term increases in adverse health outcomes among stigmatized groups. But what about the converse or flip side of this question? Namely, might longer-term declines, protracted declines in structural stigma at a population level be associated with reductions in the magnitude of the sexual orientation disparity in mental health? So that's a relatively straightforward question, but it turns out it's methodologically quite challenging to answer because you need a unique data structure that exists within a particular social context. So with respect to data, you need data sets that repeatedly assess your health outcome of interest and also your stigmatized group, in this case, LGBT individuals, which is already quite rare, especially in population-based data sets. But then you also need that data set to exist within a social context that's undergone pretty pronounced declines in structural stigma at a population level. It's proven really challenging to find a data set that exists within that type of social context. It doesn't actually exist here in the US. And so to answer that question, we've had to use a different methodological approach. Here we've capitalized on unique long-term population level reductions in structural stigma in other countries. And one of the countries that we focused on in this work is Sweden. And one of the reasons that we focused on this country is that over the last 15 years or so, it's undergone pretty pronounced changes in terms of structural stigma as reflected through its laws and policies related to sexual orientation. So this is a figure showing some examples of these shifts, these policy shifts. So for example, in 1999, discrimination in employment based on sexual orientation was made illegal. And just 10 years later, same-sex marriage was legalized in Sweden, a full 6 years before that occurred here in the US context. And then not surprisingly, these legal changes were mirrored by changes in social attitudes related to same-sex sexuality. So these are data from the European Social Survey, which is a nationally representative survey of Swedish adults. And this is showing the percent who agree or strongly agree with the statement, gays and lesbians should be free to live life as they wish. And you can see here that over this same time period, a nearly monotonic increase such that by 2014, about 92% of the general population agreed or strongly agreed with this statement, again, significantly higher than what we see in the US context. So in order to determine whether these reductions in structural stigma surrounding LGBT individuals at a population level were associated with declines in the magnitude of the sexual orientation disparity in mental health, we use data from the Swedish National Public Health Survey. These are nationally representative surveys of Swedish adults and that starting in 2005 began to include measures of sexual orientation identity. So here are the results here on the, I don't know which one to point to, I'm going back and forth. Go over this side. So on the y-axis here is the percentage of the population meeting criteria for elevated psychological distress. On the x-axis are the three different time points. The data were collected in 2005, 2010, and 2015. And then finally on the z-axis here is the structural stigma measure. So this is what I showed you in the two previous slides. We just combined the attitudes and policy index in each year, given how strongly correlated they were. And I'm just plotting what you've already seen, which is the kind of pronounced declines in structural forms of stigma as reflected in attitudes and policies over the study period. So I'll be showing the results stratified by sexual orientation identity. First, you can see a fairly pronounced reduction in the proportion of gay men and lesbians meeting criteria for elevated psychological distress over the course of the study. In contrast, there's essentially no change among the non-stigmatized comparison group. And in fact, the interaction between year and sexual orientation was statistically reliable, indicating that this is a significantly stronger reduction among the LGBT sample as compared to the heterosexual comparison group. But most important for our purposes here, for our research question, is what happens to the size or magnitude of the sexual orientation disparity following these declines in structural stigma at a population level. Well, you can see here in 2005, gay men and lesbians were about three times more likely to meet criteria for elevated psychological distress as compared to heterosexuals. But 10 years later, following these declines in structural stigma at a population level, the disparity had been eliminated. And so these findings begin to suggest that these disparities aren't inevitable, but instead are responsive to changes in the social context, and in particular to longer-term protracted declines in structural forms of stigma at a population level. So turning now to a third methodological approach that we've used to examine whether these changes in structural stigma are associated with changes in health, we've used a different methodological approach. Here we've leveraged divergent geographic mobility patterns to examine life course variations in structural stigma exposure. And in particular, we've examined what happens when a stigmatized person moves from a different structural stigma environment to a new structural stigma environment, and in particular, moving from high to low structural stigma environments. So this was a project my colleague John Pachankas took the lead on. And in this study, we used a really large-scale data set from Europe. This included nearly 124,000 sexual minority men living in 48 European and nearby countries. And one of the novel aspects of this data set is one of the few data sets to include measures of stigma and also geographic mobility. And so it turned out that respondents in this data set had been born in 179 different countries, and over 16,000 of them had moved from their country of origin. And of that group, we had a sample of about 12,000 individuals who had moved from a higher to a lower structural stigma environment. And importantly, they had varying lengths of exposure to this new low structural stigma environment. And so with this new data set, we could examine whether among movers, longer exposure to these lower levels of structural stigma in the receiving context is associated with lower levels of adverse mental health outcomes, as measured in this study by, they had two measures. One was depressive symptoms and one was suicidality. So we measured structural stigma in two different ways in this study, very similar to the study in Sweden that I just mentioned. So first were country-level laws and policies surrounding LGBT people globally that were measured across three different areas of legislation, including criminalization, recognition, and protection. So you can see here quite a bit of heterogeneity and variation across these different countries with respect to their policy climate. So just take one example. The eight countries that are shown in red had implemented the death penalty for homosexuality. This measure of policies was then combined with a measure of population attitudes that was obtained from the Global Acceptance Index. So here, individuals across numerous countries had answered survey questions about their general attitudes and acceptance towards LGBT people. We then aggregate those individual responses up to the country level, such that each country has an average stigma score. Given the really high correlation between attitudes and policies, we combine those into a single index. And as a reminder, we have that measure both for the sending countries, but also the receiving countries as well. So here are our results. This is showing on the y-axis the country-level prevalence of depression. And then on the x-axis is the country-level structural stigma. This is the measure from their country of origin, structural stigma. So we divided the sample into two different groups. First, I'll be showing the results for recent movers. So these are shown in blue. These are individuals who had moved to the lower structural stigma country 4 years ago or less. So for this group, you can see that we continue to see a fairly robust association between their country of origin structural stigma and their level of depression. In contrast, the red line here shows the association for individuals who had moved 5 years ago or more, and therefore had a much longer time of exposure to these lower levels of structural stigma in their receiving country. And for this group, we no longer see an association between their country of origin structural stigma and levels of depression, as indicated by the flat line. We find very similar results for suicidality. Again, among those who moved 5 years ago or more, we see no association between their country of origin structural stigma and current levels of suicidality. So taken together, these results indicate that the adverse mental health consequences of exposure to structural stigma in one's home country weaken the longer that one individual lives in these more supportive receiving countries, that is, receiving countries with lower levels of structural stigma, providing some additional evidence through a different methodological approach that these changes in structural stigma exposure are associated with health outcomes. So these are just a couple of examples of different methodological approaches that we've used to explore the relationship between changes in structural stigma and the health of LGBT populations. We recently finished a systematic review and meta-analysis of this literature. And since the first paper that we published in 2009, there have been about 100 studies that have used objective measures of structural stigma and linked it to health outcomes that have been measured among LGBTQ populations. The overall effect size for structural stigma ranged from an odds ratio of 1.2 to 1.48 and was observed across a range of adverse mental, physical, and behavioral health outcomes. indicating that structural stigma is reliably associated with poor health. This effect size was comparable to, and in some cases larger than, many other well-established structural level risk factors for poor health, including some of those that I've listed here, like income inequality, racial residential segregation, neighborhood crime, and neighborhood socioeconomic status. To further contextualize these findings, we also examined the population risk attributable to structural stigma. So it's estimated that a little over 20 million individuals currently identify as LGBTQ here in the US, and that proportion is increasing in more recent born cohorts. So if half of those individuals are exposed to high structural stigma environments, as current estimates suggest, the population attributable risk is equivalent to approximately 1.8 to 3.6 million LGBT people experiencing poor health as a result of structural stigma exposure. And then finally, our meta-analytic estimates indicated that structural stigma was not related at all to the health of the non-stigmatized comparison group. So again, we're showing specificity just to the group exposed to these structural forms of stigma. So I'm going to switch gears here to the second part of my talk. So far, I've been talking about some of our work documenting main effect associations between structural stigma and adverse health outcomes, using a range of measures and methods. But this doesn't answer an important question, and that is, what are the mechanisms through which these very broad structural and institutional forms of stigma ultimately contribute to adverse health outcomes? And that question and mechanism is important for a couple of reasons. First, because it has potential intervention implications. If we can identify mechanisms, we can potentially target psychosocial interventions to address them. But also because it improves inferences if you can identify plausible mechanisms through which structural stigma contributes to adverse health outcomes. So in the systematic review that I mentioned, we found 90 studies that had examined relationships between structural stigma and outcome measures that themselves could contribute to poor health and therefore may serve as potential candidate mechanisms linking structural stigma to poor health. So I'm about to do what I tell my students never to do, which is to show really busy, messy figures. But this is sort of the best way to show it, which is this is the conceptual model that we developed in the systematic review that sort of synthesizes the multiple different potential mediating pathways that emerged from this review. And we identified a couple of potential pathways linking structural stigma to health. So the first are individual and interpersonal level stigma processes. So many of these studies showed that factors like internalized stigma, concealment, perceived discrimination, and victimization are all elevated in high structural stigma environments. A second category was healthcare-related processes. So for example, studies showing reduced access and engagement in care in environments characterized by high levels of structural stigma. A third category was general biopsychosocial risk factors, so factors like social isolation and stress are also similarly elevated in high structural stigma contexts. And then finally, a couple other, a handful of studies looking at both material resources and relationship and family processes as additional potential mechanisms. So I'm going to present a couple quick studies today on some of our recent findings that have focused on one class of mechanisms. Specifically, we've been interested in examining whether structural stigma may initiate a cascade of both psychological and physiologic stress responses that may in turn may represent one mechanism linking structural stigma to poor health. So first, starting with psychological stress mechanisms. So in one study focusing on psychological stress, our measure of structural stigma was exposure to negative campaign ads that occurred during voter referendum on same-sex marriage. So as many of you know, voter referendum here in the US are commonly used to expand or limit the rights that are accorded to different marginalized groups. And perhaps no other group here in the US is more exemplary in this regard than LGBT people. So between 1974 and 2009, there have been about 160 referendums, voter referendums here in the US concerning LGBT people, with over 70% of those referendum restricting or rejecting their rights. And so in this study, we were interested in whether exposure to campaign ads that occurs during a particular voter referendum might increase psychological stress responses among LGBT people. So this is a paper that a colleague of mine, a political scientist, Andrew Flores, took the lead on. And to answer this research question, Andrew strategically combined two different data sources. So the first data source was the Gallup Daily Tracking Poll. This is a nationally representative sample, and it just so happened that the data were being collected in four states that were undergoing or about to undergo an election and that included a voter referendum on same-sex marriage. So our measures of sexual orientation and psychological distress come from that data set. And then the second data source here was our measure of structural stigma, which came from the Campaign Media Market Group, which we purchased. So these are objective media market data on TV campaign ads for and against same-sex marriage that had been aired in the 4 weeks leading up to that vote. And so with these data, we knew the number of campaign ads, both on same-sex marriage, both for and against, that had been aired within a particular media market. And so that was our independent variable in this study. An advantage of using these objective campaign media market ad buy data is that we're not reliant on the self-report of respondents about the extent to which they perceive that they've been exposed to these campaign ads, which can inflate or overestimate associations with psychological outcomes, including stress. So the innovative design feature here that Andrew came up with is that it turns out that these TV media markets actually cross state boundaries. And so it turned out that there were individuals living in 12 states who were unintentionally exposed to these media markets, but didn't live in one of those four states that were about to vote on those referendum. This group is known as media market spillovers, and they're used by political scientists to approximate experimental designs in real-world settings. And so we take advantage of this unique data structure by comparing people who lived in those media market spillovers with individuals in non-spillover markets with no ad exposure. So here on the y-axis is the proportion of the population reporting psychological distress. On the x-axis is total ad exposure. On the left-hand side here is the stigmatized group. On the right-hand side is the non-stigmatized group. And you can see here that we find that increased exposure to campaign ads were associated with greater self-reported psychological distress among the LGBT spillover sample. For example, those living in communities with 400 ads had about a 34% greater probability of reporting stress compared to those living in areas that were not exposed to ads. And again, we see result specificity, so no association at all between ad exposure and psychological distress among the non-stigmatized comparison group. We also conducted a couple of sensitivity analyses to test the robustness of these findings. So first, we found that ad exposure was not associated with outcomes that were assessed in the Gallup Daily Tracking Poll, that it shouldn't be associated with it, for example, lifetime cancer diagnoses. Secondly, we showed that ad exposure was not associated with our outcome variable, in this case, psychological distress, among LGBT individuals who lived in match media markets. So these are media markets elsewhere in the US that were nearly identical to those media markets with ad exposure, but that had not gotten, not received ad exposure. So there's no association with psychological distress among individuals living in those match media markets. And then finally, ad exposure was not associated with psychological distress among LGBT individuals who lived in that same spillover market, but who had been assessed in an earlier time frame, that is right before the ads were shown. So across these three different sensitivity analyses, our results provide some further evidence for the validity of these inferences about the relationship between our indicator of structural stigma and psychological distress. So this study examined psychological distress is a psychological stress is a potential mechanism measured via self-report, but we've also been interested in another line of work and the extent to which structural stigma may also be associated with physiologic stress responses, in this case measured by HPA axis reactivity. So to address this question, we've used a different methodological approach. Here, of course, we can't randomly assign individuals to live in high structural stigma environments. The IRB is not going to let us do that for good reason. So we can't use traditional randomized experiments, but we can take advantage of the fact that individuals have been exposed to different levels of structural stigma throughout development, something I mentioned in a previous study, which enables us to examine structural stigma as a moderator of a variety of psychological and physiological and behavioral responses to the same stimulus in a controlled laboratory setting. So this represents one way of bringing in the macrosocial context into lab-based paradigms. So I'll present just one example of this work that I did with former colleague Kate McLaughlin. So in this study, we brought 74 LGB young adults into the lab. They grown up in 24 different states, and I'll mention why that's important in just a minute. I'm showing here the demographic breakdown of the sample. They're told that the study was to understand connections between your daily experiences, your bodily activity, and health. So there's no indication the study is about stigma or the other constructs of interest. So our measure of structural stigma here, we used a composite index of four different components. So two of these are components you've already seen from our prior work, laws and policies and aggregated attitudes. But we also examined two additional potential indicators, the density of same-sex partner households who live in the state, and also the proportion of gay-straight alliances in public high schools in the state. We conducted a factor analysis, and a single factor emerged, suggesting that all of these different components are loading onto this single construct of structural stigma. So we created a factor score that we used as our predictor in these analyses. This map here is showing the distribution of structural stigma across US states according to our index. So what's a little different in this study is that we measured people's prior exposure to structural stigma, this case during adolescence. So we asked them, where did you spend the longest period of time between the ages of 10 and 18? What state were you in? And we did that because we know from the developmental literature that this is the period of time in which individuals are beginning to initially report same-sex awareness, also beginning to identify as LGB, even if they haven't disclosed that identity to others. So we're coding the state where they had grown up based on the level of structural stigma according to our index. And then all of them had moved to New York, which is one of the top three lowest structural stigma states in our sample. And so our research question here is, how does prior exposure to varying levels of structural stigma as an adolescent affect subsequent physiologic stress responses as measured in the controlled laboratory setting where everyone is responding to the same stimulus? So what is that stimulus? We use the Trier social stress test. Some of you may be familiar with this. Very briefly, they come into the lab, they get acclimated, and they're told that they're going to have to give a 5-minute speech in front of two individuals who they're told are trained in the evaluation of speech. But of course, unbeknownst to them, these are research assistants that we've trained to give only neutral feedback. So they don't smile or nod or give any kind of affirmative feedback. And to really heighten the social evaluative threat component of this task, they have to talk about a time in which they've been rejected or discriminated against based on their sexual orientation. And remember, they've never met these people before, so they don't know their attitude. So it's sort of ambiguous situation that heightens the social evaluative threat and really makes the task identity relevant. As if that's not bad enough, after the speech, they have to engage in a 5-minute stress math task where they're given a preposterously high number. They count backwards by sevens. If they mess up, the research assistant yells at them. So not surprisingly, a meta-analysis showed that this produced one of the most reliable stress responses as measured by cortisol, which was our outcome here. So we collected neuroendocrine samples via saliva that were subsequently assayed for cortisol at three different time points over the course of the study. So on the y-axis here, I'll be showing the cortisol output on the x-axis with three different time points. So time one is the baseline after they get acclimated. Time two is the reactivity measure to the stressor, and time three is the recovery. These results are stratified by prior exposure, comparing those who grew up in low versus high structural stigma environments. So you can see here that controlling for numerous factors that affect cortisol response, we see a blunted or hypocortisol response among individuals who grew up in those high structural stigma environments. And that type of hypo or blunted cortisol response has been observed now in numerous samples exposed to chronic stressors, including kids exposed to childhood maltreatment and individuals with PTSD. There's been work identifying some plausible neurobiological mechanisms through which this type of chronic stress exposure might result in hypocortisolism. I'm suggesting, at least in a preliminary way, that the stress of growing up in these high structural stigma environments may be exerting biological consequences that are similar to what have been observed with other chronic life stressors. At the same time, though, I want to hasten to note that we can't assume that this pattern of blunted cortisol response is necessarily adaptive or maladaptive, given that previous studies have shown that psychosocial stress exposure is associated with both hyper and hypocortisol responses. And so as a consequence, we sought to replicate these findings to determine the extent to which our results are consistent when we measure other physiologic systems that are also responsive to psychosocial stress. And one of the ways we've done that is a recent study that a former postdoc of mine, Robert Paul Juster, took the lead on. And just very briefly, in this paper, we used data from the NHANES, a nationally representative data set, which included measures of sexual orientation, We knew the state of residence of the respondents, so we could link in externally a measure of structural stigma in the form of state-level policies. And then it included 11 measured biomarkers representing cardiovascular, metabolic, and immune functioning. So we were able to examine associations between exposure to structural stigma over the roughly 10 years in the study and examine its association with allostatic load by combining these different biomarkers. And in short, we found, in fact, that LGB adults living in these states with higher levels of structural stigma was associated with greater allostatic load after controlling for several different individual level risk factors, including health behaviors, demographics, and the like. So we do have some consistent evidence now across different measures suggesting that dysregulated physiologic functioning resulting from chronic stress may represent one mechanism linking structural stigma to poor health outcomes. So in the last little bit of time that I have today, I'm gonna switch to the third part of my talk, which is we'll focus on intervention implications. So when we think about stigma interventions, they tend to come in two forms, and I'll mention briefly both. The first are interventions that are aimed at reducing some of the negative health consequences of exposure to stigma, such as, for example, psychotherapy. And while these treatments in general may be effective, in a recent line of work, we've been interested in examining the extent to which their efficacy may depend in part on the social context in which these interventions are done, and in particular, may depend on the level of stigma in the environments in which those interventions are conducted. So in order to examine that question, we needed a method where we could study interventions across a range of social contexts that vary with respect to the level of structural stigma. It's turned out, though, that that's very challenging to do because most intervention studies are done in a single place. There's, of course, nothing wrong with that. These are very resource-intensive and time-intensive to do. But from the purposes of where you're interested in examining structural influences on intervention efficacy, it is a problem when studies are done in one place because everyone's exposed to the same macrosocial context. It's essentially a ubiquitous exposure, so there's no variability in which to detect an association with intervention outcomes. So to address that limitation, I teamed up with a colleague of mine, John Weiss, and one of his former postdocs, Maggie Price, who took the lead on this paper. And we used a relatively recent approach called a spatial meta-analysis. This is very similar to a traditional meta-analysis with the added step that you just geolocate where these studies are done and then link in your measure of the contextual variable of interest and examine its association with study outcomes, in this case, intervention efficacy. So in our project, we reanalyzed a large meta-analysis of 194 youth psychotherapy randomized controlled trials that John Weiss and his group have been collecting over the last many years. And the innovation here is that we took advantage of the fact that these interventions have been conducted across the U.S. in communities that differed in terms of the level of racial prejudice in those communities where the interventions were done. And we measured that by aggregating individual attitudes towards race in the communities that had been assessed in national surveys. We aggregated those up to the community level where those interventions were done and then linked them into the meta-analysis to examine them as a moderator of intervention efficacy. So here are results. On the y-axis is intervention effect size. On the x-axis is the community-level racial prejudice score ranging from low to high, stratified by studies that were conducted with majority Black youth compared to majority white youth. So you can see here on the left-hand side that for studies with majority Black youth, controlling for a variety of contextual-level factors, those interventions that were done in communities with higher levels of community-level prejudice have lower intervention efficacy. In fact, the intervention effect size were three times as large in interventions in that were conducted in communities with lower levels of racial prejudice. Also, if we look at interventions done in communities with at the highest end of community-level racial prejudice here, you can see the confidence interval overlap zero, indicating that these interventions are no more effective than control conditions in those communities. In contrast, again, specificity to the stigmatized group, there's no association between community-level racial prejudice and intervention efficacy in the non-stigmatized comparison group. We also found a significant interaction between community-level racial prejudice and time since the intervention was conducted among studies with majority Black youth. So here are those findings. On the y-axis, again, bless you, is the intervention effect size. And on the x-axis is the assessment period, stratified by the immediate post-period shown on the left-hand side here, so immediately after the intervention was done. Comparing to the follow-up, this range in time, but it was typically about 12 months post-intervention. I'll be showing the results for in red are interventions conducted in low prejudice communities, and in green are interventions conducted in high prejudice communities. So first, interventions conducted in low prejudice communities. You can see here that the intervention effect sizes continue to increase over time after the intervention relative to the control condition. This is exactly what we want to see in cognitive behavioral-based interventions like those tested here. In contrast, we see the exact opposite among those interventions conducted in high prejudice communities. Here, the intervention effect size continues to erode over time, suggesting any minimal initial benefit that was accrued through the intervention declines over time. Another research group study conducted by Alicia Reed and her colleagues have replicated these findings, showed very similar results for HIV prevention interventions. Again, lower intervention effect sizes in high in communities with higher levels of racial prejudice. So I think taken together, these findings are beginning to really push us to think about how we go about testing these interventions and thinking about adapting them and modifying them in high stigma communities, especially because these findings are suggesting that these interventions are less effective precisely in those communities where they're most needed. These findings also point to the importance of developing interventions at the structural level and that target stigma at its source. The predominant approach, though, in psychology for in terms of interventions that are focused on this second approach of reducing stigma at its source has really been focused on at the individual level, or more rarely at the group level. And these interventions include a variety of approaches, things like empathy building and perspective taking, education, contact, intergroup contact. We spent now decades of research testing these interventions and millions of dollars testing their efficacy. So what have we found? Well, in a word, these interventions have been underwhelming. This is a meta-analysis that Betsy Pollack and her colleagues published just a couple years ago in the Annual Reviews of Psychology. They assembled 418 experimental studies reported across 309 manuscripts. And here's their abstract, which I'm just going to read. So 76% of all studies evaluate light touch interventions, the long-term impact of which remains unclear. The modal intervention uses mentalizing as a salve for prejudice. Although these studies report optimistic conclusions, we identify troubling indications of publication bias that may exaggerate effects. Furthermore, landmark studies often find limited effects, which suggests the need for further theoretical innovation or synergies with other kinds of psychological or structural interventions. We conclude that much research effort is theoretically and empirically ill-suited to provide actionable, evidence-based recommendations for reducing prejudice. So this is certainly a sobering assessment of the field, pointing to the need for much more research to develop effective interventions to reduce stigma and prejudice, especially those at the structural level. So to conclude with the figure that we started with, we've shown in our work that structural stigma contributes to a variety of adverse health outcomes among members of stigmatized groups. We've also begun to identify some of the biopsychosocial mechanisms through which these broad structural forms of stigma may influence health, although certainly we need a lot more work understanding what those mechanisms are. And in addition, our work is beginning to suggest that structural stigma not only affects the health of stigmatized individuals, but may also be undermining the efficacy of psychosocial interventions among the stigmatized. As I mentioned throughout the talk, we've tried to use a variety of methods and strategies to achieve strong inferences about these relationships between structural stigma and adverse consequences. One is the triangulation of evidence across multiple measures, methods, and outcomes. And the reason for that approach is if you can triangulate evidence and find consistent associations between structural stigma and a range of adverse consequences, across a range of measures, methods, and outcomes, it increases our confidence that the results aren't spuriously confounded by any particular measure, method, or outcome that researchers are using. The second is documenting specificity of these consequences just to the stigmatized group. The third is controlling for potential confounders in order to try and rule out spurious associations. Another is conducting falsification tests to show that structural stigma doesn't influence outcomes it should not theoretically influence. Another is beginning to address plausible alternative explanations for these findings. So one of these alternative explanations you may be wondering about is, well, maybe healthy individuals just leave high structural stigma environments and sort into lower structural stigma environments, leaving the unhealthy individuals behind. So it looks like social causation is really just due to differential selection by health. So far, we haven't found strong evidence for this alternative explanation in our findings. For example, in that study in Europe that I mentioned, we can stratify by the sample among individuals who have never moved, so have been exposed to high structural stigma context throughout development. We continue to find robust associations between structural stigma and health, thereby ruling out some of these social selection hypotheses. Another strategy is identifying plausible mechanisms linking structural stigma to health, including stress pathways. And then finally, as I mentioned, replicating these results meta-analytically, therefore providing further support for the robustness and consistency of these findings. So I'll end there acknowledging all the many amazing collaborators and folks in my lab without whom this work certainly wouldn't be possible. Thanks again so much for the invitation, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you have in our remaining time. Thanks.
My question is about concealment.
Oh, yeah.
So in some studies, concealment is potentially helpful for the stigmatized population because it's protecting them from discrimination and enacted stigma. But other studies show that the concealment process itself is a stressor. So are there any studies about structural stigma that show a differential effect regarding concealment?
Yes, and thanks for the question. So in fact, concealment is probably the most studied mechanism linking structural stigma to poor health. And we find pretty consistently that higher levels of concealment in high structural stigma environments, as you would expect. And we found that actually at multiple levels. So we've measured, most of these studies measure structural stigma at a single level of analysis. But in some recent work that one of my former postdocs, Micah LaTanner, has done, is he's developed measures of structural stigma at the state, county, and city level. And at each level of analysis, we find associations with concealment. And in fact, we're also able to then look at interactions between different levels of stigma. So what's really interesting is we see the lowest levels of concealment in cities and states where structural stigma is at its lowest, which you would expect. But as state-level structural stigma increases, concealment behaviors continue to be low as long as you live in a city with low levels of structural stigma, suggesting that it's really the sort of most proximal environment that people are picking up on in terms of structural stigma. And that as city-level structural stigma increases, you start to see concealment increase when they're living in states with high levels of structural stigma. So we've shown this in kind of several different studies now. What's interesting about that finding is that it does suggest a finding that's less consistent, which is whether discrimination is higher in high structural stigma environments. Not all studies are finding that, in part, I think, because of the concealment pathway, that on the one hand, it is protecting you from overt discrimination, but concealment, to your point, is associated with a whole host of adverse psychosocial processes, hypervigilance, rumination, social isolation, all of which contribute to adverse health outcomes. So it's a somewhat complex relationship between structural forms of stigma and stigma at the individual and interpersonal level analysis, that the extent to which people are concealing may paradoxically make them at lower risk for some other forms of stigma, even while it still contributes to higher levels of adverse mental health outcomes. So, yeah. Jane, did you have a question?
I just great job, and maybe trying to do more multi-level research. That's a great example of that.
And
thank you.
I just had a question about intersectionality.
Yeah.
So great data and amazing study. I don't know if you had a chance to break any of it down. Do you see these effects differently, even for gender, sex, race, ethnicity, age?
Yeah, thanks. Okay, so two comments on that. The first is, in our meta-analysis, we looked at a variety of demographic moderators. So this is, of course, not at the individual level, but at the study level. So for instance, proportion bisexual, or proportion adults, or proportion women. None of those significantly moderated the effects. Having said that, many of these are just not well represented in studies at the individual level. And so I think that that is a very preliminary, not finding strong moderation, but I think the jury is still out until we have more studies that can test more of those mechanisms with more studies that are measuring, for example, race, ethnicity, and immigration status that we were not able to examine. So it seems like for sex and age and sexual orientation status that I think are fairly well represented in the meta, we don't see strong evidence for moderation. The second, though, is that, you know, the intersectionality theory really is about sort of interlocking structural systems of oppression, but they're often measured by demographic proxies. And so I think that what the structural stigma literature can offer, kind of that intersectional framework, is let's actually measure those systems at the structural level in the way that we have been for sexual orientation and race. And then you can start looking at the interaction of both of those structural systems together. So we've done this with two groups. We've looked at interactions with structural stigma, where we created indicators of immigration and sexual orientation and looked at their interaction. And a couple other groups have done this in the space of sexuality and race. So people are just starting to do this. You need really large sample sizes, of course, to look at that. And you need individuals sampled across a range of contexts that vary with respect to those indicators. So I think that's one of the reasons we don't see as much of that work, but I definitely think that's the direction that the field kind of needs to go. And then the third piece of that is a long-winded answer, but there's a lot to say about it. The third is all of these, the other thing about intersectionalities, there's something, of course, about the intersection of we're capturing structural forms of stigma related to these identities separately, but they're, according to the framework, should be something unique at the intersection. How we measure, you know, laws and policies are really passed for single groups, single identities, or single status characteristics. So finding measures that really truly capture the intersection, I think, is also a challenge. I think we can do that in terms of attitudes, where, for instance, Project Implicit is measuring attitudes and stereotypes related to, for instance, Black gay men, which are different from Black white men. And so, like, if you can get the intersectional stressors and stigma at an attitudinal level and then aggregate that up to the macro level, that's one way. It's certainly not the only, but I think that that is a real challenge in this space, and I think it's exciting direction for future research, but it really has not been the focus, you know, in the work thus far. It's hard enough to get one, but now I think we're sort of there, and so that makes a, you know, sense to sort of explore other intersections, yeah, other identities. There's one.
Really enjoyed your talk.
Thank you.
There's so much that I could talk about, but I was actually interested in hearing everything about at the interpersonal level as well as the macro level, the role that social support systems play. And obviously that's a huge part of the literature at this moment, but I kind of wanted to know how that fits in at a structural level.
So measuring social support, but structurally.
Right, and
yeah.
How that sort of mitigates
yeah.
the poorer health
yeah.
outcomes within
yeah.
the LGBT community.
Yeah, yeah, thanks for that question. So a couple things to say about that. Really the way that social support has been measured in these studies is largely at the individual kind of, or the perceptions of social support. And actually, interestingly, a lot of that has been looked at more as a mediator than a moderator, so that structural stigma can lead to greater levels of social isolation, therefore lower levels of social support, which in turn, you know, are associated with worse health outcomes. That link has been tested now in several different studies that I can think of. So less as kind of stress buffering, but more as a mediator. I think it's a great point of the only studies I'm aware of thinking about it more structurally is looking at community level support and integration, for example, with LGBT communities as a potential protective factor. There's maybe one study that's looked at that as a moderator, but the only other one is the kind of related process is thinking about social capital, but kind of at a more structural level. There are a couple studies that have looked at social capital as a mechanism. But I think it speaks to, I'm gearing away from that, it speaks to the broader question of, I think, that our work speaks to, which is it's important to measure these factors at multiple levels of analysis. You know, there's perceptions of social support, there's social support embedded at the dyad, but then there's also, to your point, structural factors, and we're not great at measuring those processes at the structural level. And so I think maybe that's something that stigma literature also can offer some of those related field is how to think through operationalizing those factors at the structural level. Yeah.
And I know that you had introduced like gay-straight alliances as a part of the structural stigma, and so I'm wondering how things within someone's physical built space, like gay meetup places, like clubs and stuff like that for the community, actually kind of build in and mold that lower or higher structural
level. The kind of meso level.
Right.
Marla Eisenberg has looked at some of this in her work, where she's developed measures of sort of community level structural stigma, kind of at that meso level. And she looks a lot at those kind of at the organization level, like you're suggesting. What's the, what are LGBT community centers in the area, for example, is one indicator of that. So I think thinking about what those indicators are across different stigmatized groups is an important direction, for future research. Yeah.
Hi.
Hi.
That was an excellent talk.
Thank you.
I had a question. It might be a little bit silly, but my head always goes back to the data collection, right? I work at the bench primarily, but a lot of the analysis that one does, right, is affected strongly by the data that one is processing. And I think there are, I'd like to hear your thoughts on laps in the pool that you're pulling data from to test an analysis, because I assume there are gaps in, is the data accurately representing the population that one is studying, and how that affects the outcomes that one gets from these meta analysis like that? If you're not even if there are already existing outliers in the data itself, how do we go about mitigating that? Is it looking at it at a census level? Are we asking the right question? Adequate questions that is more inclusive of the population, so we could infer and get better results on the output of it. I don't know if that makes sense.
No, for sure. Definitely not a silly question at all. I think so here's a way we've thought about this in our own work. The first is, when you study concealable stigmas, there's always this challenge of how you capture the population. And so one of the main strategy we've used is to use probability-based studies that do not specifically recruit on that population of interest for the following reason. A lot of research on stigmatized groups uses non-probability samples, often called convenient samples, a term I hate because there's nothing convenient about collecting data. It's challenging. But there's nothing inherently wrong about those approaches, because in many ways you're capturing a subcomponent of the population. But when you're interested in stigma-related factors in particular, like for example concealment that came up earlier, when you're going to places, for instance, gay bars or LGBT community centers, you're capturing people who are at higher levels of outness, so lower levels of concealment. So you're restricting your range of that variable, which may then mean that you're finding no association between structural stigma and concealment, but it's just because that you've selected in part on that variable and there's no variance in it to examine it. So we've been using these population-based data sets that look very different from non-probability samples for LGBT populations, but also for other stigmatized groups as well. Those samples have their own limitations, though. They're the smaller sample size, so you can't address issues of intersectionality often, back to Jane's question. So they offer some strengths, but they have some limitations. So I think I'm a sort of, as you probably saw in my talk, a big tent approach in terms of method and sampling and measurement. I think that I always look for triangulation. Are you finding consistent results across both approaches? Because there are strengths and limitations of each. And so if you see triangulation, it improves the inferences, I think, that we can draw. In the meta-analysis, we did not see a really strong difference between non-probability versus probability samples, suggesting that, at least for health outcomes, that's not contributing a huge source of variation in those studies. To your point, you always have to think about who's showing up in the data, but most importantly, who isn't. And I think that the answer to the who isn't differs in non-probability and probability-based designs. And so hopefully by using both approaches, you're sort of triangulating and addressing that issue by using both approaches. So hopefully that begins to answer your question. Yeah. Yeah, sure.